Take your Bibles and turn with me to Matthew chapter 1. This morning we're going to take a different approach to Christmas. We're going to talk about the boring Christmas story. I mean, when you stop and you think, let's be honest, when you stop and you think about the Christmas story, there have been a lot of stories that have developed around Christmas that are anything but boring. I mean, you got the story of this reindeer with a red nose that nobody likes, but he turns out to be the hero. That's not boring. That's a pretty good story. Then you've got those adventure kinds of stories where the bad guys are there, like Scrooge in the Christmas Carol. You know, the Bah Humbug. He doesn't like Christmas. He would like to do away with it all together. Or the Grinch that stole Christmas. Another story. Great stories. I mean, tension when the Grinch steals everything, puts it in the bag, you know, and carries it off because he has no heart. Good story. You got stories where little girls get their dreams, like Miracle on 34th Street. Or angels get their wings, like It's a Wonderful Life. But then you come to Matthew chapter 1. And you've got so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat. You know, I really think, as I'm sitting here this morning, I'm thinking, I made a bad mistake, a tactical error in preaching this message right after Thanksgiving. You know how that turkey kind of puts you to sleep? I'm afraid that when we start reading Matthew chapter 1, that some of you will start dozing off. But what do you expect? I mean, Matthew, after all, was an accountant, right? Not noted for, no offense to any accountants that may be in the room, but they're just not noted for being the most exciting people in the world. I mean, if you've got somebody that's never read the Bible, that's never studied the Scripture, the place that you don't want them to start is Matthew chapter 1. Because they start reading, so-and-so begets 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 so-and-so, and you start going, Matthew, come on! Why do we start the Christmas story in Matthew chapter 1 with all of these begetting? Why not jump over to the angel visitation? Now, that's something pretty exciting. When the angel shows up, that gets the blood going, you know? I mean, just think about it. If an angel showed up this morning, you would say, Terry, get out of the way. It would be pretty good. Why not start with Joseph and the struggle between, do I divorce her, do I marry her? What tension. That makes for a good story, very dramatic. Why don't we just go over to Herod? There's another bad guy. He killed all the little boy babies. Let's get to him. But no! Matthew says we've got to slog through all of these so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so. We got to go through all this process just to get over to the good stuff. Why not start with the celebration of the wise men? No, we have to start with this boring stuff. And then I started thinking about it, and I said, you know, if the Bible is what I say it is, if I think it's inspired by God, it must be there for a reason. If that's really the Bible is the Word of God, then it must be there for a purpose. God doesn't waste words. He didn't just put it there for filler. There must be a reason for it being there. And as I started looking through it and I started understanding it, I began to realize, you know, this stuff isn't really boring at all. It's the story of Christmas that gives me hope that I can be a part of the story. And that you can be a part of the story. That the Christmas story is still being written even today, and that we can participate in that story. There is some really good stuff in here if we get beyond the so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so, and we look to see what does this say and what does it mean to me this Christmas season. So this morning, we're going to tackle the boring story of Christmas. Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. Are you there? Hold your Bibles up. Now, this is going to be one of these sermons that you can laugh at because I can't pronounce half the names that are in here. So if you're here today and you're a stickler for correct pronunciation of Greek and Hebrew names, I'm sorry. I'm just apologizing ahead of time. You'll just be bored one more time. So let's begin in Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. Are you there? Here we go. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Isaac. The word genealogy there is the word, Greek word for Genesis, the beginning. It's important. Abraham begot Isaac, Isaac begot Jacob, Jacob begot Judah and his brothers. Judah begot Perez, Zerah by Tamar, Perez begot Hezron, Hezron begot Ram, Ram begot Abinadab, Abinadab begot Nahshon, Nahshon begot Salmon. Are you bored yet? Poke the person next to you and say, try to stay awake, it gets better. Salmon begot Boaz by Rahab, Boaz begot Obed by Ruth, Obed begot Jesse, Jesse begot David the king begot Solomon by her, who had been the wife of Uriah. Solomon begot Rehoboam, Rehoboam begot Abijah, Abijah begot Asa, Asa begot Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat begot Joram, Joram begot Uzziah, Uzziah begot Jotham, Jotham begot Ahaz, Ahaz begot Hezekiah. Try to say that three times really fast. Hezekiah begot Manasseh, Manasseh begot Amnon, Amnon begot Josiah, Josiah begot Jehoconeth and his brothers about the time they were carried away into Babylon. And after they were brought to Babylon, Jeconath begat Shealtiel, Shealtiel begat Zerubbabel, Zerubbabel begat, I can't pronounce that one, we'll forget that one, begat Elkam, Elkam begat Azor, Azor begat Zadok, Zadok begat Akim, Akim begat Eliad, Eliad begat Eleazar, Eleazar begat Matan, Matan begat Jacob, and Jacob begat Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called the Christ. See, y'all didn't think I'd make it through all that, did you? Is everybody still awake? Verse 17, so all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations. From David to the captivity in Babylon are 14 generations. And from the captivity of Babylon until the Christ are 14 generations. And we've heard from the Word of God, and everybody said, amen. Amen. This is the boring story of Christmas. And yet it's not really boring when we understand it. This is what Matthew wants us to grasp, and you've got to understand this. If you don't understand how Jesus is connected to the past, you will never understand who He is and what He came to do. You have to understand that Jesus, number one in your outline, that it shows us that Jesus is the climax of the Old Testament. He is the pinnacle of everything that's gone before. He is the fulfillment of every prophecy. He is the fulfillment of every promise. He is the fulfillment of every rule and every commandment. He came and was the climax to everything. He is the pinnacle of all of history. We discover in Matthew chapter 1, the book of the Genesis of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. And in verse 17, so all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations, and David to the captivity of Babylon are 14, and from the captivity of Babylon till Christ are 14 generations. Now we get hung up on numbers. Don't worry about the numbers, because that's an approximation. We're not talking there about literal interpretation of how many subsequent generations came. What we're dealing with there are multiples of seven. Seven is the number of perfection. And this is what Matthew is saying. He was saying from Abraham to David was perfection. And the perfection just gets louder and louder and louder. Perfect, 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 until Jesus shows up on the scene. And He completes everything. He fulfills everything in the law and everything in the prophets. He is the one that everyone was waiting for. From the beginning to Jesus, He is the climax of it all. Listen to me. He is the story. The Old Testament story, it's not about Israel. It's about Jesus. The New Testament story is not about Israel and you and me. It is about Jesus. He is the climax of everything. There are people that come into this world who have a great impact. And yet this passage reminds us that Jesus is connected to history like no other person ever. He's connected to history unlike President Obama, unlike President Reagan, unlike Winston Churchill, unlike Adolf Hitler, unlike anyone who's ever been and anyone who ever will be. He is the perfection of all things. He is the one who came that was promised. He is everything. Not just a part of the story, but He's everything. You see, the genealogy of Jesus isn't really boring because it shows us that Jesus is the climax of all that went before. Jesus is that character in history that's tied to history like no other. After the resurrection, in Luke chapter 24, verse 27, the one thing that Jesus did with His disciples, The most important thing that he did was he took his disciples, and Luke 24:27 says that he went and he taught them where the Old Testament scripture spoke about him. From the very beginning in Genesis throughout the Old Testament, Jesus showed them that this is about me. Here's what we've got to understand about Christmas. It's not about giving presents. It's not about jolly guys in red suits and reindeer that fly. It's about the most climactic event in history. It's about the coming of the Messiah, the coming of the Christ, the coming of God's Son, Jesus. He is the climax of all of history. It shows us that Jesus is the climax. Second thing that we discover, why the genealogy of Jesus isn't boring, it connects Jesus beyond bloodlines. You know, bloodlines are important. And for the Jew, they believed the Messiah was coming. He was going to be a Jewish Messiah. He would be their Savior. But what we discover in Matthew chapter 1, verse 2 is that Abraham begot Isaac, and Isaac begot Jacob, and Jacob begot Judah and his brothers. I find it interesting that the brothers were included. The bloodline would have gone to Judah. That would have been where you trace the family. And yet this passage that we just read, it includes all kinds of people. Bloodlines are important. Unless we understand the bloodline of Jesus, we don't get it. You know, I just found out something this past week. I grew up, my mother's maiden name is Key, and we were always taught that that was because there's Indian blood back there in our history somewhere, that we were once Cherokee, and they took the last name. But as my sister began to do some genealogical research, and what she found out was that my grandfather, there's no record of him ever getting married because it wasn't under Key. What they discovered, it was under Mackey. Now, you say, well, that's kind of odd. Mackey is Scottish. And we started putting things together, and we started realizing, that's why we've got so many redheads in the family. I have an uncle and a cousin and second cousins and other uncles and aunts that all have red hair. We kept thinking, you don't see a lot of American Indians with red hair. Listen, bloodline is important. In the bloodline that's listed here, it lists not only Judah, which Jesus was biologically connected to, but all of the brothers, because he was the Messiah not only for the tribe of Judah, but for all of Israel. But that's not where it ends. The bloodline begins to expand because you and I can be under that bloodline, because people that are found there are light-skinned and dark-skinned. They're Jews and they're Gentiles. They're rich and they're poor. They're wise and they're foolish. All of us can fit into one of those categories. The truth is, the boring story of Christmas isn't all that boring because you and I can be in the bloodline of Jesus. He is the Messiah for all. That changes things. Listen, you can't understand the Christmas event. You can't understand the Christmas story without understanding the bloodline. When you understand the bloodline, it all makes sense. Here's what we got to understand. This one who came at Christmas, he came to expand the bloodline. It's not just the Messiah for Jews. He's the Messiah for everyone. Including me, which lets me be a part of this story. It's not a white man's religion or a Western religion or an old people's religion. It's a dynamic religion that's universally available. That's what this boring story is all about. It's about one who came that was connected to history and was the climax of everything, and one who came to expand the bloodline of the family of God. I don't know about you. Makes me want to sing Christmas carols. Makes me want to tell this boring story. Third thing that we discover, not only does it connect him to, as the climax of the Old Testament, not only does it connect him beyond bloodline, it connects Jesus to grace. Listen, I'm big on grace. I love some of the people that are included here. Did you notice the women who are excluded? Sarah's not mentioned. Or Miriam, the sister of Moses, the prophetess of God. Neither one of those ladies are mentioned. But in their places are some ladies that, well, let me put it this way. They weren't included because of their moral uprightness. They weren't included because they were good people. They were included because of the grace of God. It connects Jesus to grace. Listen to what it says. And Judah beget Perez by Zerah, and Zerah by Tamar. Tamar was one who played the prostitute. She was a Jew that played a prostitute. Perez beget Hezron, and Hezron beget Ram, and Ram beget Abinadad, and Abinadad beget Nashon, and Nashon beget Salmon, and Salmon begot Boaz by Rahab. Rahab was the prostitute in the promised land, in the city of Jericho, that hid people. Not only was she a prostitute, she was a liar. She's included not because she was a good person. She's included because of the grace of God. And Boaz begot Obed by Ruth. Ruth was not a Jew. She was a Moabitess. She was one excluded from the family of God by the Jews. And then to top it all off, Jesse begot David the king, and David begot Solomon by her who had been the wife of Uriah. That's Bathsheba. If you know anything about the story at all, you have to understand that David stole Bathsheba by having Uriah killed. It was cold-blooded murder. It was calculated. He sent him into battle and then withdrew the army from around him so that he would be certain to be killed. Listen, these women were not included because they were good. These women were not included because they were upright and religious. These women were included because Jesus is connected to grace. Let me explain it so you can understand it from another story. When I was growing up back in Tennessee, my parents used to tell me the story of Santa Claus. How that he's making a list and checking it. Going to find out who's naughty and... Yeah, let me tell you. Someone's been checking a list. And guess what he found out? That you and me have been naughty. Yeah. That's what the Bible says, that we are all sinners. But here's the good news. Someone did something nice for me. This story of Christmas is not boring at all when you begin to understand it connects Jesus to the grace of God. And it lets me understand and come into that grace because He went to the cross doing something nice for me, taking the penalty for my sins and your sins so that I could be forgiven and that I could be part of the Christmas story. When God checked His list, I was naughty. And so were you. But the Christmas story, this boring story, it reminds us that Jesus is intimately connected with the grace of God. And that we can be included because He's done something so very nice. Last thing. Not only does it connect Jesus to grace, it confirms God's commitment to His promises. After they were brought to Babylon, Jeconath begot Shealtiel, and Shealtiel begot Zerubbabel, and Zerubbabel begot Abed, and Abed begot Elkiam, and Elkiam begot Azor. I'm not going to read them all. We get down a little bit further. It says, and Jacob begot Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called the Christ. The Babylonian captivity comes and goes, and for 400 years there is no prophet. For 400 years there is no word from God. For 400 years there is silence. People must have started wondering, what about the promise of God? This is what God promised Abraham. God said, Abraham, I'm going to take you to a place. Do you realize that Abraham never owned any property except for the tomb where he buried his wife and where he was buried? This is what Hebrews says, though. It says that Abraham saw a city. There was foundation was laid not by the hands of men, but by God. And that's where he was headed. And David was promised a king that would reign on the throne forever and ever and ever, but he never lived to see it. What about the promises? What about what God promised Abraham, and what about what God promised to David, and what about what He promised us, that Jesus is coming back? Sometimes when there's 400 years of silence and nothing happens, it becomes easy to give up on the promise. It becomes easy to discount the Word. It becomes easy to forget that God is committed to what He says.
14 generations passed. 14 more generations passed. 14 more generations passed. And then Christmas, the Messiah comes. He steps on the scene, confirming everything that God had said, finalizing everything that God had promised, completing the promises, the covenants, fulfilling every requirement. So that you and I can be a part of the Christmas story. So that you and I can be a part of this grand story that what God has promised, He will do. I remember when I was growing up, I remember one Christmas season, my Aunt Bobby, she decided to decorate her front porch. And so she cut out of wrapping paper a Christmas tree. And she wrapped up all these boxes and stuck them on the front porch underneath the tree. And somebody had the audacity to go and steal those boxes and open them. Now, I got to tell you, the boxes looked great, but they were empty. I mean, there was nothing in them. Ruined a really pretty front door, but I mean, there was nothing there. You see, for some of us, we look at the promises of God and we see them with all kinds of potential, but we're not sure if there's anything there or not. That maybe they're just all wrapped up, but they're empty. What this Christmas story teaches us is that what God has said is full. That what God has promised, He will do. It may take 400 more years. It may take 14 generations and 14 generations and 14 generations, but God will honor what He said. God will do what He says. God will accomplish what He promised. I guess what I've got to recognize is that this boring story of Christmas isn't all that boring after all. What I've got to recognize is that it ranks right up there, maybe as the most unboring story of all, when we understand it. When we understand that Jesus is the climax of history, that the birth of Jesus connects Him beyond that bloodline and a biological bloodline, and it connects Jesus to grace, and it confirms God's commitment to the promise, and it's invitational in that it invites me to be a part of the Christmas story. Now, you know, I went out, I picked up a paper Wednesday. You know, did you get the catalog, Kansas City Star, you know, with all the Black Friday events? I mean, it was this thick. It was, some of you are old enough to remember the Sears and Roebuck catalog. That's what the newspaper kind of reminded me of. I mean, it was thick. It was thick. All kinds of possibilities. Listen, we get all caught up into that story of Black Friday shopping. You know what? This Christmas season, let's get caught up in the story that when you first look at it, looks kind of boring. But when you dig into it just a little bit, you begin to understand. It's the Christmas story about you and about me. It's the story of Jesus and about us. So the question becomes, how can I be a part of the story? Went through all these lames, all these names that are on here, the ones that put us to sleep. But how can I be a part of the story? Because here's the truth. If I'm in the story, it's no longer boring. Isn't that the way you think? If we're part of the story, it suddenly changes. Not boring anymore. Well, let me tell you, you can be a part of the Christmas story. Because the Christ came for you. How do you become part? Three things. Number one, you must accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord. This is not about being a part of a church. It's not about attending church. It's not about preaching sermons or being a good person. It's about accepting what Jesus did on the cross as your only hope of salvation. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. You must accept Jesus as your personal Savior. That's the way you become part of the story. Secondly, you must commit yourself to follow Him. You've got to make a decision. You got to make a choice. You can't just continue to celebrate Christmas as usual. You've got to decide, you know what? This is something that I need to do. This is something I'm committed to. I'm going to follow Him. I'm going to try to do what His Word teaches me to do. I'm going to try to apply it to my life. I'm going to try to live what He says. And then lastly, you have to trust Him to transform you. You got to trust Him to change you. Listen, it's not about pulling yourself up by your own bootstraps. This is about surrendering our lives to Him. It's about giving Him full control of who we are. This morning, I want you to know the story doesn't have to be boring. You can be a part of it because Jesus came for me